the per unit system applied to distributed generation. Hello everyone, my name is Rafael. I am an electrical engineer, and in this video I would like to invite you to discuss with me the use of the per unit system in electrical power systems containing distributed generation. And to do so, I am bringing this exercise to our debate that I have been researching. I am going to read the exercise and show you the solution. Per unit system applied to distributed generation, the exercise. The figure shows a distributed generation power system consisting of a three-phase 480 volts, 60 hertz, small hydro generator supplying two loads through a distribution line with a pair of transformers within substations at either end of the line. This is the information the exercise provided us for the generator, the transformers, the distribution line, and the loads. Pay attention that although the generator is rated at 1 MVA, the transformers are rated at 500 kVA. Therefore, we need to pay attention to not exceed the rated apparent power of the transformers. Okay? Letter A. Sketch the per phase, per unit, equivalent circuit of this power system. Letter B, with the switch open, find the complex power supplied by the generator. What is the power factor of the generator? At what percentage of its full rated power is the generator loaded? Letter C, with the switch closed, recalculate all parameters of letter B. And letter D, calculate the line losses with the switch open and closed. What is the effect of adding load 2 to the system? Okay, my friends, let's solve it. Let's go to the solution. We wish to use the per unit system, and whenever using the per unit system, we need to establish base values for region 1, the region of the generator, for region 2, the region of the distribution line, and for region 3, the region of the loads. First of all, region 1, the region of the generator. We are going to use the base values for the voltage. VB1 will be 480 volts. The base value for the apparent power of region 1, 1 MVA. And with these values, we can calculate the base value of the impedance. VB1 squared divided by SB1. And if we use these values here, we find 0.5 value here for the base impedance of region 1. We are going to do the same for region 2. Let's do it. Let's do the same for region 2. For region 2, we need to observe the voltages of transformer T1. See here that it is 480 volts, 13 kV. Then, as the base voltage for region 2, we're going to use 13 kV. The base apparent power, we're not going to use 500 kVA, we're going to use 1 MVA. For this reason, we are using 1 MVA instead of 500 kVA, we will need to adjust these values here, the values of the series impedance of this transformer. We're going to do this adjustment later. So here, 1 MVA. And if we use 13 kV here and 1 MVA here, we find 169 ohms. Okay? This is for region 2. Now let's see the values for region 3. We are going to follow the same reasoning. Okay, for region 3, but see that the transformer 1 is different from transformer 2. Transformer 1 is 480 volts, 13 kV. Transformer 2 is 480 volts, 13.8 kV. Then, we need to do some adjustment here. I'm going to tell you. Observe that the turns ratio of transformer T2 is 13.8 kV divided by 480 volts, and this is 28.75. Okay, we are going to use this turns ratio here with this voltage here to come up with the base value of the voltage for region 3, which is at the other side of transformer T2. Then it is going to be VB3 will be equal to 13 kV divided by 28.75, which gives 452.17 volts. See here that it is different. It is not 480 volts, it is 452.17 volts, okay? Why? Because the turns ratio of this transformer is different from this transformer here. Had they been equal, the base value for the voltage of region 3 would be 480 volts, but they are different. Here is 480 volts, 13 kV. Here is 480 volts, 13.8 kV. Then we need to do this adjustment, and it turns out that the base value of voltage for region 3 is not 480 volts, it is 452.17 volts. And using this value, we're going to use SB3 here, equal to 1 MVA. We are not using 500 kVA, we are using 1 MVA. Then we will need to adjust these values here, okay? We're going to do this later. And using this value, we find that ZB3 is equal to 3 squared divided by SB3, and we find 0.2045 ohms. Okay, this is the base value for the impedance in region 3. Now let's do the adjustments. I had said that we need to adjust these values here because we are using different values for the base apparent power. Instead of using 500 kVA, we are using 1 MVA. Therefore, we will need to carry out these adjustments. And the expression that we are going to use for this adjustment is what does it mean? It means that we are converting from one per unit system to another per unit system. And to carry out this conversion, we need to use this expression here. We're gonna have one impedance in one per unit system, and we need to convert it to another system, and we're going to find the per unit value in another system. Subsequently, all we need to do is to substitute the values. The series impedance in the adjusted per unit system is going to be 13 kV divided by 13 kV. Because we're using the same voltage for the first per unit system and the second per unit system, but here we are going to use different values for the apparent power. Here it was used 500 kVA and in the adjusted system 1 MVA. If we conduct this multiplication, you're gonna find the per unit value of the series impedance of transformer T1 we are going to adjust this to be equal to 2. We are going to use the same method to adjust these values here for transformer T2. Observe that the transformer is rated at 480 volts, but we're using 452.17 volts. Then we need to adjust this. Likewise, transformer T2 is rated at 500 kVA, but we're using for the system 1 MVA. Then we need to do this adjustment. okay? 0.004 here, 0.085 here. We are adjusting these values, and then we find for transformer T2, the adjusted value of the series impedance is 0.085. Okay, what does it mean? It means that in our calculation, instead of using this value and this value, we are going to use this value and this value. And for transformer T2, instead of using these values, we are going to use this value and this value here. Okay. Now what we need to do is to convert this impedance, the impedance of the distribution line, into per unit. We simply divide this value here by the base impedance of region 2, which is the region of distribution line. It's going to be 1.5 plus J8 divided by 169, which is 0.085. We are going to do this conversion for the impedance of load 1 and the impedance of load 2. We are going to divide this value here, 0.5 phase 36.87 degrees ohms, by the base impedance of region 3, and we are going to divide this value here, negative J times 0.833 ohms, by the base impedance of region 3, and then we find this value for load 1, and for load 2, we find negative J4.073. With these values, we can calculate the current of the system when the switch is open and when the switch is closed. Firstly, let's calculate the value of the current when the switch is open. The value of the current when the switch is open is going to be the current in per unit. The division between the per unit value of the voltage of the generator and the combination of the loads. The impedance of transformer T1, the impedance of the line, the impedance of transformer T2, and the impedance of load 1. Load 2 is not participating when the switch is open. Observe, pay attention on this, observe that when we use the actual system, when we want to observe the actual system in watts, amperes, volts, in their actual value, the current of the generator is different from the current of the line, which is different from the current of the load. Why? Because there are transformers. And the reason for employing transformers is to alter the current that passes through the line. We wish to diminish as possible the magnitude of the current along the line. That's why we use transformers. Increasing the voltage is just a consequence. The main objective in using transformers is to decrease as much as possible the current that passes along the line. Why? Because by decreasing the current, we decrease power losses. High currents, very big currents, mean high power losses. But when the current is small, we have small power losses. That's why we use transformers to decrease as much as possible the current that passes through the lines. However, when we convert the entire system into per unit, only one current is going to flow from generator to load, passing through the transmission line or distribution line, okay? That's why we use per unit. One of the reasons, there are many reasons, one of the reasons is to have only one current flowing throughout the entire system. Okay? And this current here is going to be, if we use the values in per unit, the current is going to be 0. Value of the current, we can calculate the complex power supplied by the generator. Firstly, in per unit, going to be the multiplication between the per unit value of the generator's voltage and the system's current. But the complex conjugate of the current and then we find the value of this is in per unit, not in kVA, kilowatts, kVAr, this is in per unit. To convert it to kVA, we need to use the apparent power, the base value of the apparent power of region 1. Then the powers of the generator will be the generator is supplying an apparent power of 1. Observe here that the generator is supplying the system an apparent power which is less than the rated apparent power of the transformer T1 and the transformer T2, okay? 364. Alright? Then this value here is within the rated capability of this transformer and this transformer. Had this value been higher, we'd need to use other transformers. But for this value here, we can safely use this and this transformer here. This is when the switch is closed, is open. When the switch is open. The power factor of the generator is 36% approximately 36% of its full load rated value. Now let's do the same for letter C. Letter C asks us to recalculate when the switch is closed. Let's do it. To calculate letter C, we need to consider buff loads. They will be in a parallel connection. The combined impedance is going to be the parallel connection between Z-load 1 and Z-load 2. And we find a value of 1. Calculate the current when the switch is closed, we are going to use this equivalent impedance as we did before. is going to be the division between the voltage of the generator in per unit and all these impedances here. And we find a value of 's is the value of the system's current when the switch is closed. We are going to use this value to calculate the complex power provided by the generator when the switch is closed. Therefore, when the switch is closed, the complex power supplied by the generator will be 1 per unit, the per unit value of the voltage of the generator times the complex conjugate of the current we just calculated. And we find .322 in the phase 7.95 degrees per unit. The next step will be to convert from per unit to kVA. And to do so, we need to use the base value for the apparent power of region 1. In this way, using the base values for region 1, we find that observe that now the generator is supplying the system with a smaller apparent power. Why? Because the reactive power has been diminished. The addition of load 2 causes the system to require less apparent power from the generator. The power factor of the generator now is 32% of its full rated capacity. Now let's calculate the line losses. when the switch is open, the current is 0. Okay, then to calculate the line losses, we need to multiply the per unit value of the current by the per unit value of the line impedance. This is in per unit. To understand this value better, we need to convert it from per unit to watts or kVA. And the real power loss in transmission or distribution line is going to be ₩1.2 kilowatts. This is the power that we lose in distribution line when the switch is open. Now we're going to calculate it all again for the case when the switch is closed. For the case when the switch is closed, the value of the current is We are going to convert this from per unit to kVA. and the real power lost along the distribution line is ...918 watts. And the last question the exercise asked us was, what is the effect of adding load 2 to the system? Adding load 2 reduces line losses in 21%. Let's recalculate it. It means that by adding load 2 to the system, we are reducing distribution line losses by 21%. Okay? We are losing less power along the distribution line when we add load 2 to the system. Okay, my friends, this was the video that I wanted to make. I hope you guys enjoyed it and learned from it. I am a teacher. If you want to book a lesson with me, use my WhatsApp number, guys. Goodbye!